You live a life of ups and downs, up here today and gone tomorrow. Oh, changes you can't control. They fill you with gloom and sorrow.
Gracious God, our Father, we thank you again for this wonderful opportunity and privilege to go and come, go out by way of voice and come into people's heart, living room, minds, automobiles, by virtue of technology, communicating one for the other on this medium. Now, God, our Father, we know that this is a day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be exceedingly glad in it. Thank you again, O God, for those who worked so arduously that we might have this telecast presentation on Sundays and other times that we hope that will be beneficial to the hearers. Now, God, our Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray that you'd bless us and bless the heroes of the things that we believe that thou hast ordained for us to hear. And then we go out and be doers of the word. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. On today, I would to look at verses in the Bible that probably are very familiar with each of us and yet maybe not so familiar with others. In the Gospel according to St. Matthew's, the 9th chapter, we want to commence reading at verse 9. And we're always coming from the King James Version. Again, Matthew's 9th chapter, beginning at verse 9, and we shall read down through verse 13. And Jesus passed forth from thence. He saw a man named Matthew sitting at the receipt of the custom, and he said unto him, follow me. And he arose and followed him. And it came to pass that as Jesus sat at meat in the house, behold, many publicans and sinners came and sat down with him and his disciples. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said unto his disciples, why eateth your master with publicans and sinners? But Jesus heard that, and he said unto them, they that be whole need not a physician, but they that are sick. But you go and learn what that mean. I will have mercy and not sacrifice, for I am not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repent of. Thank God for the word of God. I would to give us something to think about on today as the Spirit of the Lord will guide. He followed him. He followed him, giving emphasis on verse 9. Needless to say, and without controversy, there is now a worldwide epidemic, not only of this pandemic challenge of this COVID-19 that's going worldwide, but sickness, epidemic diseases, contagions of infection, pollutions of impurities, illnesses, and deadly poisons that plague the human population. Now, we know that there were many such catastrophic pandemic situations and events recorded that has threatened the annihilation of humanity throughout all generations. And just for a moment, just to name a few in these last, let's say, 500 years. For instance, the American plague that was brought over from Europe in the 16th century, namely the Great Plague of London, that an estimated 90% of the Western Hemisphere's civilization was reputedly killed off. The native North American Indians suffered most from this dreaded disease, from both the desire for colonization and occupation of a people to the point of genocide. Also, the Great Russian Plague of 1770 through 1772 was so devastating that an estimated 100,000 people have died after the plague has ended. The Philadelphia Yellow Fever epidemic of 1793, the flu pandemic of the late 1889s and 1890, notwithstanding the Spanish flu, the Asian and the AIDS pandemic, the swine flu just 10 years ago was responsible for over 500,000 deaths worldwide. And just a few years ago, the West African Ebola epidemic, and today, the coronavirus, which some had labeled China for being the culprit for this outbreak. Laying blame does not lessen the enormity and the suffering and hardship placed on our society. In retrospect, worldwide horrific deadly events, incidents of unimaginable proportion that are mind-boggling to the senses, are not alien and foreign to this planet in which we habitat. Deadly diseases are not only health conditions that is usually manifested through some germ contaminant within or on the body, but may have their roots also in the minds and the hearts of those who bring about devastating wars on human life and limb, though through greed and selfish motives. Likewise, our society has gone through many changes and facets of moral and immoral erosion. The very fabric of what is called good, acceptable, right versus wrong, and should be maintained as what is called normal, have been attacked by the disintegration and breakdown of the beliefs and trustworthiness of the eternal word of the eternal God. There is this philosophical, analytical reasoning that undermines the faith of the true gospel and seeks to replace God's word with pseudo-human logic, temporary solutions that promises to fix all difficult life experiences and narrow it down to self-help, man-made religion, excluding God's grace and mercy and excluding the love of God. So many times and way too often we forget that it was the Lord Jesus Christ who left his ivory palace in Glory and came through the history of 42 generations of man, saying unto him, whosoever will, let him come unto me and drink from the fountain of the living water, and he will never thirst again. John 4:14, paraphrase. We shout and we sing, God is not dead, when there is death all around us. And yet we long for the decaying, the dying, and the temporary things of this world. It was Peter who always spoke out and out of turn, and said to Jesus, Lord, we have left everything in this world to follow you. What shall we receive in the life to come, in the hereafter? What shall we receive for leaving everything and following after you? Matthew 19:27. Peter, who also spoke up, and he also was the first one to talk and say this. Peter was still into that doing for something crowd. What's in it for me? But at least he did have a mind to focus on following Jesus beyond the temporary and the now. Some of Jesus' followers can only see that side that tantalized the flesh and traumatized the spirit. Jesus had to remind Peter, everyone that has forsaken, abandoned, and disattached himself from desiring the things of this world, houses and land and kinfolks and relationship, for my name's sake, and follow me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit on his throne, you shall sit upon 12 thrones, you and my disciples, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone that forsake these temporary trinkets for an eternal, for my name's sake, shall receive 100 times right here in this life on earth, but also shall inherit everlasting life. But many that are first shall be last, and the last shall be first. I think we shall be among the last receiving the first. That's good news. The Lord has to always instruct his disciples in things concerning heaven, which we know very little about. Those of you who followed me in this world on into the regeneration, when your genetic DNA has been transformed from earthy into the eternal hereafter, you'll sit with me in my glory, and these seats, Peter, are specially reserved for you and you and my disciple. In our text on his holy earthly mission, Jesus passed by the custom house of the Roman governor, and there he sees and said to this tax collector, this man, a society outcast because of his work and his employer. He is disliked by the populace of the people and certainly by those who held religious position, although they were hypocrites themselves. They were allowed to hold these so-called sacred seats to appease the conquered Israel nation by their conquering foes, the Roman Empire. When people are allowed to worship their idolatrous deities, their man-made gods, and other so-called sacred images, they are most likely to behave in a certain non-aggressive way. Give him his idol gods and give him all that he desires of his religion, he will give you his obedience, his allegiance in his ignorance. In our text, Matthew, labeled a crook, hated and despised by all the Jews, hypocrites and non-hypocrites alike, simply because of his occupation. For no man's own work can produce offspring for Adam's seed and bring about the promises of God through the flesh of sinful men. Therefore, God had to intervene, change, reverse, set aside the affairs of men to bring about his divine plan, to which he predetermined before the foundation of the world. took on a house resembling a body of a flesh and became flesh to accomplish that which man could not do for himself. We live in a world where there are no incident or event that is so horrible or a crime that is so dreadful enough to shock our moral conscience anymore. We have become so desensitized to just about every evil that has been committed and are being committed. But as often as it is, there are those who give the impression of supporting their pretenses with much outward show of religious piety and reverence for God as being genuine, but their hearts are far from God. In this text, just before our text, this pretext before our text, Jesus has just finished healing a paralytic man who had a nervous disorder, and he was unable to move, and he was weak. Those who brought him to Jesus had faith and believed that if he could, they could just get him to Jesus. They believed that Jesus would heal him. So they brought him to Jesus lying on his sick bed. Now, it doesn't matter what the condition and what the situation and circumstances are. Just get them to Jesus. Notice, it was the faith of those who brought this sick paralytic to Jesus. If you have faith to take it to Jesus, maybe, just maybe, that sick person, that wayward boy or girl, that hardcore husband, that bad-mouthed son or daughter, or supervisor who has troubled you to no end while you do your job that you're supposed to do, and we would that you be a good spouse also, like you're supposed to be. Maybe you need to take them to Jesus in faith. He's able. I tell you, he's able. Yeah. They believed in Jesus and took him to Jesus. Jesus forgave his sins and healed him on the spot. Now, our text said, Jesus walked by, saw a tax collector named Matthew. And this is Matthew's own testimony of what Jesus said unto him. In another writing of the Good News, Jesus called Luke from writing prescription drugs, ordained him to write the history of the early church and scripture for healing of the brokenhearted. Luke 4:18. Jesus called Matthew Levi, or rather Luke called Matthew Levi. In the gospel, the Lord ascribed to him, Mark called him Levi also. He was sitting at the seat of the custom, making money for the Roman Empire and making money for himself too. Under the table, you know, paying no taxes for his earning and overcharging those in his jurisdiction. But Jesus walked by and said, follow me. And he arose and followed Jesus. Now, Matthews was not among the needy, but he was among the greedy. He wasn't poor and starving because he had a good government job. Working for a foreign government, they paid him well for the services he rendered from this mercenary government of Rome. Jesus walked by and said to him, follow me. I have another government job for you that's not of this world for you to work at. I have a long time appointment for you. I have on the job that I'm going to give you no layoffs, no downsizing, no pay cut. You have already been interviewed long ago, even before the foundation of the world. Jesus didn't scold him for being unscrupulous with his underhanded dealings and of the tax receipts, working on for an oppressive foreign government, scheming and pocketing tax money from the top and from the bottom. But Jesus just said to him, follow me. I'm intrigued because all Jesus said to him was, follow me. In another place in the scripture, known as the three synoptic gospel writing, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. This may be the same account of Matthew's being called Levi, because while Matthew's is giving an accurate account of his calling, he does not involve himself with much fanfare and description or information of his calling. Jesus simply said to him, follow me. And he arose and followed him. He left his government position, his job security, his side of money hustling, his pilfering from his own countrymen. Now, Peter, Andrew, James, and John had a fishing company, which seemed like they could barely catch enough fish to support themselves. And they complained to Jesus and talked about, Lord, we have fished all night long. We have toiled all night long and haven't caught any fish. Luke 5:5. We're just going to clean up our nets, call it quits for the day. And they had a nerve to say, we have left everything to follow you. But Jesus said unto them, just throw your net over on the other side where you have been fishing all night long and caught nothing. Just put your net over there. Peter, probably now embarrassed and probably hungry because he didn't catch nothing, said, nevertheless, at your word. Do you know that if you would just listen to Jesus at his word, he doesn't need to say a lot, just at his word. They caught so many fish, they could not bring them into the shore. And then Jesus said unto them, now you follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. And they followed him. Mm-hmm. Now, back to the text. But the text said, Jesus said to Matthew, call Levi from his Jewish ancestors, follow me. You do know that when God called you and saved you, he changed your name. He'll change your name and your occupation. He changed Abram to Abraham, Jacob to Israel. He changed Peter to stone, Saul to Paul, James and John to the sons of thunder. And now he calls Matthew from sinner to saint. Mm-hmm. Matthew's got up from his workstation. He arose and he followed him. Now, he is a disciple of Christ. And our text said, and it came to pass as Jesus sat at meat in the house. We're not told whose house, but many publicans and tax collectors and sinners, they all gathered around that house and they all came and sat down with Jesus and his disciple. And when the religious rights group who followed Jesus everywhere he went, not to be fishers of men, but to hinder and destroy the work of God. Matthew followed Jesus into the house where they were in the house eating and drinking. They probably were playing their music, listening to the latest hit song, Good Golly, Miss Molly, You Sure Like to Ball, or Save the Last Dance for Me. This text said, those who were there in the house came and sat down with Jesus and his disciple. Now you do know who else were there. Verse 10, those who had their camouflage clothing of hypocrisy attitudes saw Jesus at the party. They said unto Jesus' disciple, why does your master eat with publicans and sinners? Why does he join in with them? He's supposed to be a man of God. He's supposed to be a prophet. He's supposed to be a man of high moral standing. Now, this was the opportunity for Jesus to give them a lesson between being physically sick and sinfully sick. There is a difference between the two. Those who consider themselves to be spiritually whole and their souls to be without disease will not welcome a spiritual physician. Jesus gave them to know that if your physical health is A-OK, you don't need a physician. Your doctor has given you a clean bill of health on your last visit. Don't come back for 6 months until your next appointment. But those who know that they have spiritual needs, they are separated from God who created them, the Lord God Almighty. Those who have tried the church thing first without genuine faith in Jesus. They have tried the modern approach to spiritual healthy living. They read all the religious books on how to live a victorious Christian life. They tried all kind of self-help to fulfill their empty hearts and guilty conscience, but it just didn't work. Therefore, you come and sit at the table with Jesus, and he'll prepare a table before you in the very presence of your enemy. He'll anoint you with his holy oil of gladness, and surely goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. He'll keep you. Yes, he will. They came, the Bible said, and they sat down with him. He said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly, and I'll give you rest for your soul. I'll give you faith and grace to keep you from failing and from falling. They came and sat down with Jesus. They sat down with him who said, come on to me and follow me. I'll give you rest. They came and sat down to get their broken hearted healing. Notice, Jesus didn't send him to the priest, didn't send him to the synagogue, didn't send him any place to do something. Just follow me. And he followed him. That was enough for Matthew. Jesus told the unbelieving Pharisees, if you are sick, you need a physician. But I will have mercy on those who are sick. For I am come not to call those who think they're A-okay, but sinners to repentance. I wonder, is it enough for you to follow him? What else do you need to follow him? All you need is faith as a grain of mustard seed to follow him, and the mountain of unbelief will move from in front of you. There are so many different prophets, preachers, teachers, gurus out there. So many false prophets and false religion out there. They all come with their camouflage clothing, with their message of health, wealth, and prosperity. But when you follow Jesus, you got it all. Some came with their new lies, telling you that we live in a new culture, in a new age, millennium. But there is nothing new under the sun. Jesus, the same yesterday, it's the same today, and he's the same forever. Paul followed Jesus and was assured, when this earthly house of this tabernacle is dissolved, he have a building not made of hand, but eternal in heaven. Peter followed Jesus, and Jesus gave him the keys to the kingdom. James followed Jesus and became a great leader for the church up at Jerusalem. Priscilla followed Jesus and became the pastor of the great congregation in the Corinth church. Barnabas followed Jesus and became a great evangelist for Jesus. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they all followed Jesus, and they wrote the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, God's only begotten Son. My grandfather, my grandmother followed Jesus. They all followed Jesus. He called me, and thank God I'm following him. And one of these days, we all shall see him over there where the wicked shall cease from troubling. Our weary soul shall be at rest. Why don't you follow him into that land where I'm bound, where Jesus went? All of God's children will go there. Just follow him. God our Father, we thank you for the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We pray, O God, that your word will find great good soil and germinate into life everlasting, or cause growth to come into somebody's heart. In the powerful name of our only God and Savior, who loves us unconditionally, that we might come and follow him. Amen.